Right!
Wednesday edition Discussions of Truth. I'm your host, Ian Hamilton Trottier. Check me out on iantrottier.com. Follow me on Twitter. Follow me on Instagram. Both handles, IANTROTTIER. What do we do on this radio program? Exactly what you just heard Hetfield screaming. Well, you hadn't heard him yet, but if you go on listening to that song, the title of it is Seek and Destroy. We seek out corruption. We seek out lies. We seek out deception. Political, corporate. Our goal is what your goal should be as an American and any other American listening to my voice right now, whether it's live or it's on replay, should be to destroy those elements of your country and society and human existence globally. Now, three quick talking points before we bring on first guests. Yes, you get a doubleheader today. Quickly, we go to former guest on the program, Daniel Estulin. What message did Daniel bring to this program? Just so happens that Estulin sold millions of copies of his book. So, America, the question is, where do you stand? Because those millions of copies were overwhelming majority outside of the United States. It is a Nobel Peace Prize nominee. His books, totally banned in the United Kingdom, which means he's dug up something that the UK banking and political system doesn't want their people to know. Wow, really? So what kind of society and government have they built over there? Because as our current and existing in 2018, closest ally along with France, where do we as Americans stand? Because let's not forget, though we speak their language, they at one point were our staunch enemies. Do not forget that. So, do we embrace Estulin's message and allow it to resonate? And do we continue to hold up the standard of liberty and freedom for all? For all! Freedom of press, freedom of religion. Seek out deception, but give everybody the chance to be honest. Do we continue down this path of censorship in government and in large corporations? Disabling people from speaking out against corruption. Whistleblowing. Or do we collectively as Americans begin to support that? Even Twitter is blocking messages from average, everyday Americans as being sensitive. So where do you stand, America? Where do you stand? No major New York publisher would pick up Estulin's books, yet they sold millions of copies worldwide. Two times did he win Mexico's Top Journalism Award. He's not even Mexican. He's a former Russian intelligence officer living in Spain. So what is it about the United Kingdom and why they ban his books? And why is it that only a small publishing house out of Oregon was willing to print his book in the U.S.? Where do you stand, Lady Liberty? America? Free and independent? For who? That is the question that we must ask ourselves in 2018. That's A. B, Hurricane Florence moving in again threatening the eastern seaboard. We just had Irma last year. They're very devastating to the Keys. I went down there. I spent probably 5 weekends in a row helping clean up people's disaster. I'm not saying a hurricane is not a threat. Sure it is. It killed people. It wipes out people's lives. I ask you to visit iantrace.com and find the link that'll send you. It says it right there. Weather as a force multiplier, U.S. Air Force. Yes. If you live in the United States, it doesn't matter either. I guess it doesn't matter where you live in the global. There, the military has the ability to control your weather. In fact, if you listen to Ilana Freeland last week, disaster capitalism. You can actually wager bets. You can place bets on how bad a projected hurricane or natural disaster can be. That's fact. That is fact. Thanks for listening. Next, Google it. Mr. James Pars, CIA whistleblower. Somebody with sensitive information regarding that person at a Central Intelligence Agency contacted me last week. Google it. Mr. James Pars. Yet another burdening possible CIA whistleblowing case. Possibly projected to totally turn upside down DC is coming to your frayed political system in the United States. And you have to ask yourself, why? Because a United States is not a divided state. But there are groups out there basically and frankly essentially making money off of the fact that they are proud to divide you. Pick this side. Pick that side. Quarrel amongst yourself why they laughed at the bank. Don't do it, America. Unify under Constitution, basic elements of the Constitution. That is my argument. I will be right back to bring on today's first guest while we enjoy a moment. Ashraf Ramala. This is Ian Trache. You have tuned into Wynwood Radio. This is your weekly edition, Discussions of Truth. Yes, a little master of puppets. We have online with us today Ashraf Ramala from Egypt. Ashraf, tell listeners, tell us exactly what you're doing, Dr. Ashraf Ramallah, please tell listeners exactly what your project is doing. You are fighting for religious freedom in Egypt. Is that correct?
That's correct. First of all, I have to thank you for the invitation to be in your program. I am so honored. And let me tell you a little bit about being in Egypt right now. Coptics are persecuted, attacked, their home are attacked, their churches are destroyed, their business are attacked. They forced to leave the places that they used to live for years and years and years. And this is due to the spread of Islam that taken place, the deep state of Egypt. It is 100% Islamic control.
You are the founder and president of Voice of the Cops, and that's voiceofthecops.org, a human rights nonprofit organization, 501c3. The organization has offices in Italy and the United States. Are Christians leaving Egypt, Ashraf?
Yeah. They're escaping. They are not leaving. They're fleeing. I mean, the situation is very bad in Egypt, and we have a lot of youth people outside of Egypt looking for help. And this is one of the projects that I am really, spending a lot of time to find out the way to make to help these people.
And Ashraf, a question for you regarding a talking point that you and I discussed earlier. The question is, what is the solution for those who have fled Egypt and are now encamped in Europe? They mean no harm. They simply want to enjoy freedom of expressing their approach to theology and religion. What's the solution for these people?
Well, the solution from my point of view as a president of Voice of the Cops, that to give them a shelter to be living there in human manners, and we're giving them the opportunity to study there, and we create a program for about 9 months to teach them the language, to let them have connection with the people, to understand the behavior of the European people, and teach them give them the possibility to learn some work that they could go out and stand in their feet. It is a big project, and to be honest with you, Ian, we need the help of not American, we need the help of the world to help us to do this, to be succeeded in this project.
Dr. Ramallah, you were born in Cairo. You've seen struggles from your homeland in Egypt. You have found a good model, I suppose, of governance with the United States. Tell us what organizations in the United States and perhaps globally from whom you are finding traction to support you to change things in Egypt?
Well, I mean, to be honest with you, let me just explain one thing to you and your listener. I left Egypt, I was 16, and I went to Italy. I study architecture there. This is my background. I am PhD in architecture. When I came to United States in 93, after a few years, I start to realize the seeping of Islam in Europe and the United States. I start to study by myself various written books by Muslim to understand the mentality of Islam. And I realize that, sadly, a lot of Westerners, they don't understand. I could consider myself lucky because I understand and read Arabic, and they cannot deceive me with all these beautiful words that they are trying to say to anybody that doesn't understand Arabic language. Concerning the organizations that in the United States or Europe that they could help, to be honest with you, I don't know. I cannot give you any name of organization. I am looking for the people, the human being people, the people that they could understand the dramatic situations and other people living, not only because of religion, but also for you can't speak, you can't speak up, you can't express your thinking in Egypt. You can't say that the president is doing something that we don't accept it in simple way. I mean you're living in a big prison and all you follow the rules, all you are dead, technically speaking. And if you are not a Muslim, you are in big trouble. This is what's happening overseas in Egypt.
Ashraf, do you fear that censorship could come ashore to any country?
It is coming. It is coming to Europe. It is coming to the United States as well. It is very sad because now they try to muzzle our mouths with politically correct and non-politically correct, and we cannot say. I mean, if I say anything about Islam from their Quran, I became labeled like a bigot and racist. And I don't understand that the modern world, we have to be living all together in the same. Yeah, I believe that we need to live all together, but you have to respect me as I respect you.
Yes. And so for listeners, how do we in the United States, in any country out there, but certainly in the United States, because we pride ourselves on being on standard for the rest, how do we march forward together and make sure that we remain a safe haven for every walk of life? What's your recommendation?
Well, we need first of all to understand that what is Islam? Islam, from my point of view, it is a political system hiding behind the word religion. Once all Americans understand that, so I believe that we together we could go forward. I mean, for example, Hawaii, for example, they have to have places to pray inside a Christian location, and Christian cannot either have a church in their country.
In Egypt, yeah.
Why are they coming here and asking us to respect everything that they have to do, but they come in our home and they don't respect our home?
Yeah. God bless America, Dr. Ramallah. Listeners who are interested, how may they help you? How can they donate to your cause?
Well, there is two ways to help us in this project. There is La Casa Futura. We put it under GoFundMe, and I think that we send you the link for it. And also, voiceofthecops.org donate, and all the donations that we're getting, it is all, all putting together for that project for La Casa Futura.
Excellent. I will tweet both of those links. That's Ian Trottier on Twitter. I'll tweet both those links out for you after the show, Ashraf. Dr. Ramallah, thank you for joining Discussions of Truth on Wynwood Radio. I look forward to communication with you in the future.
Thank you so much for having me, and God bless you, and God bless America.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Ashraf Ramallah, voice of the cops, voiceofthecops.org. And I will tweet out those links, gofundme.com and voiceofthecops.org. I'll tweet those out after the program. We will be right back. You are tuned in to Discussions of Truth, Wynwood Radio.
I'm gonna throw my all in. If I'm gonna fall in, I'm gonna throw my all in. If I'm gonna fall in, I'm gonna throw my all in. If I'm gonna fall in, I'm gonna throw my all in. Coalition of the fresh coming through. Sticks and stones may break your bones. And these words might too.
They ain't ready for it. This is presidential suite, these MCs are Betty Fords. Bitch made, homie, y'all gon' need a steady fork. What the fuck you make me buy all this confetti for? Celebrating steady court, sipping, wishing it was 40. We're shorty dances down in Miami, consorty. My Cuban homies know it, we kick that Spanglish flow, cause it's all that we really know. Besides smoking your dro, never fuck with that blow, cause it fucks too many, I know, and I try to stick to one hoe, for show. Very quite contrary. Fuck a white bitch, I am rolling with Kush fairies. Won't stop caring, so they will continue staring. And I still say join, cause I do not mind sharing. We are peer pressured, those cigarettes on your dresser. You keep them around to measure your confidence. Nonetheless, sir, you smoke. You're puffing them up cause you can't cope. We're dope, and you might as well be dropping the damn soap. Artificial llama, we rep till the clan's broke. And when we're in your town, even the police let us toke. My homie, please let us joke. They're thinking I am not a rapper, but I rap a boom bapper since FUBU was getting dapper. Who knew that a cracker would miss it and rep the swagger? Instead of doing hacker things, a rep and Mick Jagger.
Microphone check, 1, 2.
1, 2.
Coalition of the fresh coming through. Sticks and stones may break your bones, but these words might. Two, who fucking with it? These alien flows are so acidic. You're two in the box, too orthodox like Hasidic. I stay on the clock, stay on the watch like a digit. You can say that I'm traveling, I don't stay on my pivot. Fuck a circular motion, cause forward is where I'm coasting. From a different era of who can roast the mostest. Crazy hood battles just to prove who was the dopest. No one lost their lives, but some noses got broken. That's the casualties of war when you're living. Center of the cipher and your skin hasn't thickened. And then somebody comes along, turns the keys to your ignition, and you're gone when they push your little pride to the limits. We were just children then, we outgrew our innocence like we outgrew friends. But in the end, it was no end. We're still here to amend, not here to pretend. I still got a message to send, it goes.
Microphone check, 1, 2, 1, 2. Coalition of the funk coming through. Sticks and stones might get you stoned, but ha, these words might too.
Who fucking with it? Yeah, who fucking with it? Yeah, serving these critics, take it, ascend it, back to the kitchen. If you ain't digging, the dishes ain't making a difference. I can't tailor the flavor if your palate is primitive. This is that homegrown, like the shit that we twist. I'm gone in the mist.
I love it and I'm no time. Anyway. Here we go. I'm an abductee, yeah, and I'm a mountaineer. And I was abducted out of my tent in December 1981 in the Himalayas on the slopes of Makalu, which is in Nepal, right, on the border of Tibet. And that wasn't done by the military. This was done in
Now we have online with us, welcome back. This is Discussions of Truth. I am your host, Ian Hamilton Trottier. You just heard the words of founding member of the Project Camelot. We have on the line with us Carrie Cassidy. Carrie, are you there? Can you hear me?
Yes. Hi, Ian. How are you?
Hi. Nice to meet you. Welcome to Wynwood Radio and the weekly program Discussions of Truth. Would you tell listeners a little bit about Project Camelot and the inception of it? Of course, Camelot in the name, listeners are probably familiar with the kind of utopian concept of Camelot. It's something that originates in the UK. Would you go ahead and give us a little introduction as to what Project Camelot is?
Sure. Well, we started the project about, let's see, almost 13 years ago now. Myself and my partner at the time, Bill Ryan. Actually, I started it, I guess, a few months before I met him. And then he was one of my first interviewees. He was representing the SERPO project at the time as a sort of webmaster who collated the information that was coming through from an anonymous source.
Interesting.
And I decided to interview him. And so we met and I interviewed him at the conference that was happening in Laughlin at the time, the UFO conference that was yearly. And then we sort of hit it off and he invited me to come to England as I was going to tour Egypt. So on my way back from Egypt, I stopped off in England and he showed me the power places such as Stonehenge. And we went to the former, one of the former homes in Tintagel, England, of King Arthur. And we were both inspired by the sort of legend of King Arthur and the idea of a round table, which was without hierarchy, where, you know, people could express their views, et cetera. So that was the inspiration for Project Camelot, at least naming it what we named it. And then we both decided that since I had already kind of started doing these video interviews, I interviewed a few other people at the time, since Bill Hamilton and Robert Stallus I had interviewed, and a few other people, actually, Rich Dolan, Jim Mars. I had been making a short documentary, and we decided to combine our talents. Bill Ryan was a writer and a webmaster, and I was a filmmaker, and we eventually started Project Camelot and worked together for about 3 years. And then we had a falling out on various matters and really principles, I think you'd say, and then split our operations. He went on to head up what's called Project Avalon, which is a forum where people discuss all of these kinds of things that are out there. And then I continued Project Camelot on my own and have, you know, been continuing to do that for all these years since then.
Now, you are based in L.A. You've got quite a bit of experience. You'd gone to Sonoma State. You're a native of Northern California, Mountain View. I think you were born in Mountain View or Palo Alto, so Silicon Valley. And you're also a graduate of UCLA. You have been in media, if you will, for one way or another of saying it, for quite a while. I would like you to talk a little bit about your experience in LA and media. As listeners visit projectcamelot.com, they will find that it is an alternative source of media.
Well, actually, let me just correct you there, because it's projectcamelot.tv.
Ah, okay.
Or projectcamelot.org. We could never get projectcamelot.com.
Oh,
that
pardon
was
me. Okay.
Taken and has never been released to be available. They probably would want a lot of money for it at this point. And also projectcamelotportal.com. All of those go to the same place, but the easiest one is projectcamelot.tv.
Great. Okay. Thank you. Thanks for that clarification. I actually have the website open right now, and I'm reading that it does say Project Camelot Portal, PORTAL.com. And as listeners and visitors to the site see, you've got classified information here. This is very alternative to what they're going to find on CNN, ABC, Fox, that sort of thing. Describe from a news and from a person that lives in Hollywood and what is put out by major production studios, describe exactly what they will find at Project Camelot.
Okay, well, we specialize in whistleblowers from above top secret. And right now I have a small team that works with me. I have a webmaster that I pay when I can. And I have a my current boyfriend helps out with designing banners and helping with the filming when I do in-person interviews. In the early days of Project Camelot, I interviewed whistleblowers in person. We would fly all over the world and eventually took donations to do so. And that actually kept us alive for many years, basically interviewing people with above top secret clearances who had left the military or whatever area they were in, could be an intelligence agency, although it is said you never really resign from one of those places.
Right.
And basically, I use the MTV form of filmmaking. I call it a guerrilla filmmaking style, and would put a camera in front of somebody's face and basically ask them the hard questions. And I don't do really soundbite type interviews. I spend about 2 hours generally interviewing people. And I still, to this day, I'm doing live interviews via YouTube. I have a huge YouTube following at this point. Actually, I think it's around 59 million viewers worldwide. And then my actual subscribers are around 206,000 subscribers. So that is not a small by the normal, I guess you might say, alternative channel.
Sure.
So, and I studied journalism in college, and I also have a graduate work in sociology. I was an executive MBA student at UCLA, and I was in the motion picture industry, working in that industry for about 20 years before I picked up a consumer-grade camcorder and decided to make my own documentaries.
Now, tell us exactly why it is that you felt a need to educate Americans with an alternative perspective on receiving their news.
Oh, God. Well, it wasn't just to educate Americans. It was to wake up the entire world, actually, was the mission, and still is. And we've been, one might say, fairly successful by alternative standards. I can be recognized in any country pretty much around the world, and am. So the word has gotten out. In other words, what I did and what we did was very unusual at the time. It was just, YouTube was just getting on its feet. And now everyone and their brother are doing exactly the same thing, interviewing, trying to interview whistleblowers. Some are questionable as to, whether they really are whistleblowers, but nonetheless. And a whistleblower is a truth teller who is actually breaking out of the matrix. So I don't, in the old days, they didn't even know what a whistleblower was when we started. We kind of popularized the term, widening it to include people that were breaking the truth out about what is really going on in the matrix. And if you saw the movie The Matrix, you'll know what I mean. And so it's like that. So people that live within the matrix who never question their reality and are not aware of multi-dimensions and their own higher selves, etc., won't know kind of what they're missing. And so we were doing what we're doing so that we could wake them up as to the real truth of what's going on behind the scenes. Basically, our real focus and my real focus is the Secret Space program, revealing all aspects of that, the secret government, conspiracies of all kinds, and that includes everything under the sun, from health conspiracies, where cancer has been cured in multiple ways and they're not telling you about it. Just revealing the lies that are you being told all the time, false flags that are happening around the world and in the United States, the false weather, the weather wars,
right,
that are going on,
right,
you name it.
Yeah, exactly. I think that the people anyway that are listening to my voice have a connection to questioning, and this is what I try to convey, is yes, questioning those that control the government. And in Florida, whether last week we had on Ilana Freeland and past guest of the program, I'm sure you're familiar with G. Edward Griffin, Red Pill Conference, he relates to the Matrix as well. But in Florida anyway, we got two major concerns out here. One are these hurricanes, and of course you're in California, so you've got these fires and these earthquakes, and I have become a voice, and I'm trying to become a voice to get people to actually open their eyes as to, yes, your military, and you're right, not only in the United States, this is globally, your military has the ability, and this is decades, Operation Popeye, decades, Vietnam, this is decades old, the military has the ability to direct storms. And on the stock market, there are people getting rich off of off of betting on it's disaster capital. So some of these kind of very basic elements. Go ahead.
No, that's incredible. Just let me say, while you're on this subject, that, and I, obviously we know that this Hurricane Florence is really fast approaching South Carolina and North Carolina. And I've got an article on my website about that. And a whistleblower called Eddie Page, who's predicting it to be a Cat 5. I don't know if it's reached that category or whether it will, but that's what he's saying. But aside from that, tonight at 7 p.m. Pacific time, I'm having Deborah Tavares, however you want to say her last name, as my guest. And she is you could call her a whistleblower. She's a researcher who specializes in exposing what the deep state is indeed doing about weather wars and things like hiding, these things that they're doing, which are changing the weather around us, chemtrailing, and then changing the weather, et cetera. So tonight I'll be having a very important guest talking about the hurricane and what's really going on, trying to get people. They're actually moving populations is what's happening. They're moving populations around the globe. They have, this is the New World Order, you could say, because if you ask me who they are, it starts with the Illuminati, Committee of 300, and there's a book of the same name out there if you don't know the players, and so on. Dark magicians, the secret, the aerospace community, the secret aspects of, you could say, things like Lockheed, which is an aerospace company, and then Skunk Works, which is their secret arm, and so on. So, or not so secret arm, and the secret side of NASA, you name it. And so this is the kind of thing we're really talking about.
Yeah, and there's a couple different ways to approach an understanding of what you've been at really for 12 years, and one of them would be certainly going down the oil wars chain and the Rockefellers, and for me here in Miami, it was a pesticide that was sprayed that was very controversial. There was a group that was completely outraged about it. Very small, Miami's not like a San Francisco or an LA where there's picketing and a huge, there's a small group of protesters here, and a very good friend of mine said, hey, you've got to come to this. He's a New Yorker, he lives down here, and I went to this town hall meeting, and everything that I looked into Carrie, showed me that this small little group that was protesting had complete validity. The pesticide that was being sprayed down here for the Zika virus was banned in the European Union. It was a known neurotoxin. It's known to cause microcephaly. And on the other end of the spectrum, which led me to Anthony Sutton and the Hegelian dialectic, which roots back to exactly what you just mentioned about the Illuminati, what I found was that on the other end of the spectrum, which was the cure. The pesticide was there's a link between the pesticide and the virus, this supposed deadly virus, which had been around since the 1940s in Uganda forest of Africa, which by the way, the discovery of it was funded by the Rockefeller Foundation. The Rockefellers today, Rockefeller Foundation, that is, owns the patent on this Zika virus. And then back in the 1950s, out of Walnut Creek, California, and Chevron Chemical Corporation, they were the largest shareholders of producing the pesticide. So again, like I said, that led me down totally inadvertently. I wasn't expecting to walk this road at all. And I saw the link to Anthony Sutton, who began talking about the Bush family and the secret society at Yale, which of course there's a Bohemian Grove aspect and the Owl of Minerva and all these different secret practices and how they conduct these ceremonies. But of course, I'm talking about the Skull and Bone Society at Yale and the Rockefeller and the Bush connection and the Prescott Bush and the Nazi regime. So to kind of build that kind of, I want to go two different directions, and one would be going back to your roots in the Bay Area and kind of broadening the Silicon Valley scope. And you mentioned Lockheed Martin, you mentioned Skunk Works, to give listeners an idea of exactly what's going on there, since you focus your attention on understanding really Star Wars, I guess would be a good way of putting it. And then also explaining to listeners what you know about I guess the deep state that is controlling the world economy.
Well, yes, I mean, it goes beyond the deep state in the United States. I mean, to these people at the very top levels of power, they're not looking at countries the way we look at them. They're looking at them as basically more corporations that are international, of course. And that's kind of the beginning of it. And then just basically the sheep and the wolves, as mm-hmm. they call it. So they're the wolves, we're the sheep, and they're just a lot of these things that are happening. In fact, I would even claim that you're going to find out that Hurricane Florence was mm-hmm. created, that it is a mm-hmm. storm that they have decided to batter the East Coast with, and that goes along with what has to do with the movement of populations away from the coastlines, and eventually a depopulation agenda that involves the United States in particular, but the world at large. And this is the overall sort of Iron Mountain report is one of the old reports which whistleblowers brought forward a long time ago, and things like the Georgia Guidestones that talk about their objectives in lowering the population around the world, etc. So they've had a long sort of list of items that they're trying to achieve over the years, and geoengineering, basically changing our weather, changing our land surfaces, converting the United States to large areas of just natural land where people are out of the areas, gone. And this is about getting people away from the coast right now, and other things that may go along with that. And we'd have to delve into it. It's kind of like after the fact, you can find out the most information in any of right. these situations that happen. So yeah, I mean, these things are going on. As far as the secret space program, look, I grew up in the Bay Area. I was born in Palo Alto, near Stanford, you know, in a place called Moffett Field that's notorious for having an underground base that is utilized by the secret space program. I interviewed a guy who'd worked there for probably a good 40 years underground, called Norm Bergram. The interview is available on my YouTube channel. Highly recommended. He did supposedly die in the year, I think it was 93, at the age of 93. He died about a year ago. whether he really died or whether they took him to Mars or back underground, I don't know. But he was smart as a whip at you know, when I interviewed him, which was a couple of years earlier than that. So, you know, this is the kind of thing that they have reverse aging technology. I mean, we get whistleblowers from the government and from the military, as I've said, who are reporting these things. These are men with all kinds of military rank, you know, going all the way up, and as well as high level intelligence agents, both in front of and behind the camera. So I'm getting information both ways. And that's really what's happening. To be specific, it's easier if you ask me a kind of a more specific question, because you must understand that I take a lot of this stuff for granted at this point, having seen so many whistleblowers and done so much research. This is really kind of a labor of love, you know, round the clock enterprise. I could get a call in night or day from somebody who has something to tell me. And, you know, I interview people several times weekly. Normally I do around two or three shows if I'm not traveling. So that I've got close to 700 video interviews on my YouTube channel, and I have I did radio shows for about 5 years. So if you do the math,
let's look at some of these elements that are leaking into mainstream media, because eventually that's where some of these hidden items and agenda elements will start becoming mainstream. They've been suppressed. Now they're becoming mainstream. Let's look at pedophilia, for instance. What can you tell listeners about what's going on in pedophilia?
Well, I mean, it's a huge subject. First of all, you know, it's difficult because there are a lot of ways to approach that story. So, of course, the pedophilia in Hollywood is being sort of exposed at this time. And in fact, I'm about to interview a guy named Isaac Cappy, who has come forward to reveal a lot of the pedophiles in Hollywood. I'm not sure how he's surviving, but he is doing it. And I've invited him on my show. So we're hoping to schedule that very soon. I've talked to ex-priests about it. I've talked to, you know, the Franklin scandal is an old pedophilia style, sure. Story that made the rounds. You know, the bottom line, though, is to understand it as to why it's even happening to our planet. And that gets back to our reptilian genealogy, I guess you might say, the infiltration of reptilians to planet Earth. What many Pleiadians believe, William Tompkins being a whistleblower, ex-military whistleblower who died recently, but it's an excellent interview that I did with him, and he's quite a known sort of, you might say, I don't know, alternative star before he died, reporting on Antarctica and the secret space program, how it was built up with the help of the Pleiadians on the one hand and the reptilians on the other. Then there's the Draco that right now we're told we're going to get an invasion of Draco. There are some here. I mean, it's very important to bring in the, I guess you might want to call it the non-human side of what's going on, because my understanding is that we are made up of at least 12 ET races, that our genes actually come from them, so that we are related to them. Obviously, the reptilian brain part of it is you know, speaks for itself. But what it turns out to be is that a lot of the ruling class, if you want to call it that, have a large degree of alien DNA, specifically the reptilian and Draco. They're related to them. And this gets into the Anunnaki, Zachariah Sitchin, and the story behind the things he was investigating when he was alive. Famous author, in case you don't know who he is. And so when you're looking at this story of pedophilia, you can't avoid the reptilian overlays, which has to do with blood, human sacrifice, using the fluids of humans, getting a high off them. And this is the kind of thing that has infiltrated the upper levels of our society, specifically in the ruling class and certainly in the upper echelons of Hollywood, very unfortunately. And so, you know, this is the kind of thing where children have been, you know, we have hundreds of thousands, if not millions of children. And if you go worldwide, it's probably going to be even more, that just humans that disappear out, off the face of the earth for no apparent reason. It's all because they don't acknowledge that we have we are prey. We have a predatory species that lives underground, that's helped by the gray aliens, the ones that people are familiar with, of course, from the movies. And those are, a lot of times, those can be just programmable biological entities, as they call them. But they are also an engineered race, a genetically engineered race that serves, again, is subservient to the reptilians and to the Draco. The reptilians are subservient to the Draco, for those that are wondering about that. You know, it's a huge story, but it does involve blood sacrifice. It does involve living off the death of humans, children being literally eaten, and, you know, you've got rituals, what are called dark magicians, that are performing rituals. Skull and Bones, these are organizations, secret societies that use some of these methods that goes back to the time of, I mean, it's before Crowley, you know, Aleister Crowley.
Sure.
Or Crowley, however you want to say his last name. And you know, goes way back into the early part of Europe, the Illuminati, being in Northern Europe, specifically Germany, as well as France, you know, and the Netherlands, as well as England. And they're still ensconced, you know, heavily, you know, invested in those areas. There's also a reptilian contingent in the Middle East, and various bloodlines have more or less of that DNA. And this is where actually the pedophilia is stemming back to. So how are you going to cure people of pedophilia? Not by throwing them in prison, not by trying to punish them. We're going to have to figure out how to deal with these individuals, and how to change their sort of proclivities. And when people choose the dark side, they actually, you know, choose a very dark path that involves things like that, child sacrifice, etc.
How do you see, I mean, I get a lot of talk on this program. We have looked into the dumbing down, how Americans are being dumbing down. One of the ways that's happening, maybe hear your comments on it, are vaccinations and children coming down with autism. That's, of course, a skyrocketing, in my word, epidemic. What is the purpose of that? Is it just to dumb the population down?
No, you know, vaccinations is a huge problem, as is, you know, the additives to our water, what's coming down in the skies and getting as part of the, you know, rivers and lakes and into the soil through chemtrails. I mean, this is the geoengineering of our planet, our environment, changing it so it's more conducive to actually another species, which is in essence a reptilians and grays that prefer a more methane-like radiation-filled environment and do not want as much oxygen available. So all of these things kind of work together. No one thing is isolated from the other. I don't know if I'm answering the question directly. You're sort of asking about what exactly.
I think you are. I think you definitely are. You're pointing out some elements of everyday life. As we breathe, the diminishing oxygen supply, if you will.
Right. What I was forgetting about the in terms of the vaccinations, very specifically, there is a turning these children. What they're trying to really create is precogs, and that's what's happening when you get a lot of children that are coming up with these various ailments, etc. They're looking to create. I mean, you know, the movies, the X-Men.
Sure.
This is real. This is exactly what they're looking to do. So autism works into that, and the studies have been done to show that autistic children have special abilities. And it's these abilities, especially the precog aspect. Now, not every autistic child is a precog, but I guess the ratio is high enough to where they have decided to try to jumpstart that. And they do it at the, sacrificing, you might say, the genome in other ways, such that the child may not have abilities to focus on this world that well. They can focus on other dimensions. And indeed, this is the kind of thing that they're looking for. They're looking for mutants, you know. In essence, they're creating mutants on purpose, doing experiments as if we're, a race of guinea pigs for them. And that's how they view humanity. They're doing grand and extensive experimentation on humans to create what is, in essence, what we say is a humanity 3.0, if you want to call it that. In other words, a humanity that is, as one of my whistleblowers says, a humanity that are passive super soldiers. So they are very easy to manipulate. They may be intelligent at times. They may be very psychic. They may have all kinds of special gifts and abilities, but at the same time, they will take orders. Now, that's a tall order in and of itself. You can appreciate that the more intelligent you are, the less likely you are to be deceived and to follow orders. So there are various things that they put into the chemtrails, into the water. I mean, it's famous that fluoride, for example, makes you much more conducive to following orders, makes you more passive.
That's an excellent point. And of course, historically, as listeners look back into the various operations, I think Operation Paperclip, would you say? That's been maybe one of the most influential.
Sure. I mean, it came over a lot of this experimentation, although it certainly existed before the Germans even,
right.
Created Germany. The bottom line is that with Hitler's sort of Germany, if you will, and all the scientists that came over after and during that time, it all came with them. They were experimenting on humans as part of Germany, as part of Hitler's Germany, years and years before the war. And the United States was aware of that. I think there was experimentation starting here. I mean, we have what's called the Tavistock Institute in
sure.
Britain. We've got the Rand Institute here in California. There's a Washington think tanks that are basically covers for experimentation and things of this nature. So that's really part and parcel of everything that's going on.
Carrie, what about Navy Captain Mark Richards?
Well, he's a brilliant man. He's actually, I'm on my way to interview him on the 29th of this month. And let me just say that I do need donations to help make that possible. We're actually very low in funds in Project Camelot at this time. And we do live on donations in order to survive. Once in a while I'll do a conference during the summer, and we sell the footage for quite a very low price, the videos of those speakers and so on. But basically I need donations in order to make these kinds of trips possible. It's just going, I'm in Southern California, that's going to Northern California and staying a few nights in a hotel, that sort of thing. So Mark Richards is a whistleblower. He is framed for a murder that he didn't commit the murder anyway. He was supposedly the mastermind behind the murder, which is an interesting thing to get thrown in jail over. But nonetheless, he supposedly masterminded and two younger men committed the murder. He wasn't very old when this all happened. He's now been in prison for over 30 years, and he's in his 60s. And what can I say? I'm the only journalist that visits him on a regular basis, and I have 8 interviews with him that are available on my YouTube channel. What I do is I'm not allowed to bring any recording device or, so I can't use audio, I can't use video, but I do take a pencil, and his wife accompanies me. Her name is Joanne Richards. She's also a speaker on the circuit talking about all his disclosures. He worked for the secret government in the secret space program as a Navy captain. You might think of him as a captain of an Enterprise level vessel, and so like Star Wars in essence. So he was at that level. His father was also in the secret space program, and he was nicknamed the Dutchman. So Mark grew up in the world of the secret space program and the high society. He knew Robin Williams, for example. He went to school with Robin Williams. He also said Robin was killed. He has disclosed some amazing information. One of the best, in my estimation, one of the best whistleblowers ever to come out. And a lot of the things that he said have come to pass, have been proven true. Things that he've even said were going to happen. He talks a lot about a race of beings called the raptors that is a branch of the dinosaurs that actually developed, left this planet and became highly intelligent, had space travel, and created, settled another planet in the Draco Galaxy, came back to Earth, used to be our enemies, and now have aligned themselves with the secret space program. It's important to understand that we are not alone, that that there are so many planets and galaxies out there. It's, they're virtually, I think, uncountable. It stands to reason that there are many, many Earth-like planets, and that's been even proven and put out in mainstream science now. So do the math, figure out how many species are out there, how many possibilities of species there are. There are, and then every species who has space travel, according to Mark Richards, also develops artificial intelligence at the same time. So that means we've got alien artificial intelligence. And in fact, we have evidence of that here on Earth and visiting us. And so, the story becomes very complex.
As listeners receive this information, how is it possible for them to distinguish amongst themselves? Perhaps one of them is right now a gray or related to this raptor species. How is it possible for a human being to distinguish between one another and a different race?
Well, that's a good question. This is the kind of thing you developed an intuition about. Humans are actually much more psychic than we give ourselves credit for. So you may have a sort of, your skin may crawl, you may get very cold, you may get very hot, you may have a visceral, what one would say is a visceral reaction when you meet certain people. And you might be wondering, why the hell you feel like that when you've never met the person before. Mm-hmm. Of course, there's the past life memory type thing that can also kick in. But aside from that, just on a very physical level, we do react to each other differently, instantaneously. And science never has been able to explain that. And it has to do with really your racial memory, the levels of, we are a composite of DNA, and this thing we call junk DNA is not junk at all. And they're discovering all of this. And so basically we don't even use all of our brain capacity, et cetera, et cetera. All these things are going to be kind of broken out in the news, become part of our normal understanding of who we are, that's way more expanded than what we've been led to believe. I mean, when you say the dumbing down of humanity, this has been going on for centuries and centuries. In fact, one could say since the time of about 12,000 years ago, BC, in which there was the Anunnaki came to Earth and basically colonized Earth and decided that humans were basically breeding too soon, too quickly, that they were developing too quickly, and they needed to be dumbed down. And that's the beginning of the dumbing down of humanity, from my understanding, and it has gone on and on since then, and been built into the kings and queens and how they deceived the people into believing they were, you know, higher beings or more deserving of their power, that they came from God, so to speak. And the Anunnaki were, in essence, the so-called gods that even the Greeks related to, the Romans, etc. So this dumbing down has been a process that has been built into the system worldwide and in every, you know, every race, every culture. Keeping secrets, only allowing a certain group to know the truth in certain areas, and so on. So, you know, it's very important that people start waking up to lies that they're being told.
And people globally are simply wasting their time with religious differences and political differences.
Well, in the sense that what those symbolize. In other words, you could imagine that if you have, and this is actually according to my various whistleblowers, various countries are aligned with various groups of ETs. Okay, they've made deals with them, as has the United States government. And some of those deals are with some very dark, nefarious groups of ETs. So not all these ETs get along. So the wars we have on planet Earth, contrary to what you've been taught, are not because man is a bloodthirsty beast, but because we come from races of beings who've been fighting each other in the stars above our heads, in, you know, galaxies far, far away, as George Lucas would say, for eons. And we're their descendants. And so we carry a lot of that genetic memory down with us through the ages. And therefore, if you have an innate sort of suspicion of a certain race of people, it's because you're probably from a different race of beings. And I would also say that as Ashiana Dean, who is someone I interviewed, who actually lives in Florida, and her work is, she published two books called the Voyager series. They're both called Voyagers 1 and 2. And in fact, Voyagers 2 is out on a Kindle, I believe it is. And Voyagers 1 was supposed to be coming out on a Kindle very soon because they're hard to get in hardback at this time. But anyway, and they're on the front page of my website if you want to find how to get them. She has been in touch with a group of beings which are all different races. They call themselves the guardian races, and they are guardian this seeding of humanity, if you will, here on planet Earth. And in essence, what happens is that we are, again, descended from all these various races, and this Earth is a kind of experiment to get all of these races who are battling off planet to get along, and by putting them into a genealogy that's mixed here on planet Earth in the form of humanity.
We look at the United States, for instance, and we share, prior to you, I had
a gentleman on to discuss the turmoil in Egypt. He was born in Cairo, fighting for religious freedom. In the United States, we benefit from a, let's just say it's a more stable life than other countries. In my view, I credit that to the founders, the Constitution that we've inherited. With that said, how do listeners go forward with, they now have the information that you've discovered, they understand there's differences with us, and it extends to other galaxies, really. I mean, this is we you know, as beings, we tend to think everything evolves around us. No, we certainly not. This is a much bigger issue, but we have an opportunity as Americans to, at the moment, speak our mind freely. That's highly censored, as you obviously know. How do Americans go forward to instill and to strengthen the country that they have, if that makes any sense?
Well, I appreciate the question. I have to say that, you know, some people, especially I travel a great deal, so I interact with people that see Americans rather differently than they see themselves.
Uh-huh.
Now, there is a very healthy rebellious quality to Americans, because they were brought up, even though it was actually something of a fallacy, to think that they were free.
Good point. They
are heavily programmed by their, you know, by their education system, by their churches, by their parents, you name it. And of course, that doesn't even get into the health profession and the vaccinations and the fluorescent lights and all the things that actually are dumbing you down and not helping you to be free in any way. So there's that aspect. But with given the fact that they had this sort of overlay, and our press, by the way, is heavily controlled, there is literally no freedom of the press in the United States at this time, other than what you're going to get here, like on alternative sources. And even in the alternative world, it's very heavily infiltrated by agents who work for intelligence agencies, especially like the CIA and NSA, in which they are part of the deep state and the Illuminati, and they are under the auspices and direction of the Vatican, which is run by the reptilians, by the way. And, you know, so it's a very hierarchical structure that this so-called American freedom exists under. But given that, Americans believe they are free in many ways, and because they believe it, they act like it fairly often, in my opinion. And this is where you get a very free kind of, even in Hollywood, where they are told what to show you, they can't resist giving you ways to also rebel against the system and inspiring stories along those lines. Of course, there are freedom fighters in every country around the world, including the United States. And we benefit from the amount of, you know, rebellion, the amount of truth seekers that are in any given country at any given time, and through the ages, who have been heroes to me and others, and, you know, inspired us, such as, you know, John F. Kennedy, who was killed because he wanted to reveal the ET presence, change our monetary system, etc.
Yeah.
So this saga continues. I mean, you know, we are only free to a point. And as a matter of fact, it's beginning to, or has been at least up until the time Trump took office, beginning to look like this place was going the way of Nazi Germany.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, I do believe that the Trump administration and the side of the Navy that is backing him is responsible for maybe turning this ship around to some degree. It may be a limited you know, hang out, as they call it, a sort of a short-lived bit of success. But nonetheless, I think for as long as it can run, I do hope that it will be successful. And I do believe that there are some very good intentioned people that are fighting the secret government and fighting the deep state at this time. Now, there are aspects which may not be as successful as others. There are aspects of the individuals who are running this place at this time. And listen, you know, in my view, the president is a figurehead. He right. may have some input, and he may be able to kind of, in this case, he's kind of a wild card. I do think he's well-intentioned. I actually do. And I believe he's got some very good people around him. But I do think they're fighting an uphill battle. They may be... It says there's 40,000, I think that's the number, 40,000. It sounds crazy. Arrest warrants that are about to come due or be actualized. I hope we live to see that. Mm-hmm. This kind of thing's going on here in this country at this time. It's, you know, there's a lot of other things. You know, these battles are going on, are also being played out with the fires in Northern California.
Right. Sure.
With the fires in Oregon and Washington and
Canada.
And with this latest group of hurricanes. Mm-hmm. In other words, these weather wars are being conducted both by aspects of our own government against our government to make Trump look bad, to weaken certain areas of the South, to weaken, you know, some of the foundations of our country. So, you know, there's a lot at work right now, and it's a very exciting time to be alive. I think it's a great time to speak about truth. We haven't been shut down yet from that. So for as long as the internet is alive and well, and we are able to speak, then I think there's hope. They knocked off my YouTube channel for two interviews I did with Ole Domegaard and Jim Fetzer.
Really?
About false flags in America. Mm-hmm. And I'm the interviewer, and they knocked me off. So that's you know, really trying to do away with freedom of speech and freedom of the press all in one fell swoop. But they didn't succeed in giving me a third strike. And then I bounced back from the first two strikes, which happened back in March. And I finally got them to take those off. And so basically my channel is alive and well at this time. But that could change tomorrow. I can tell you right now, you cannot use the words false flag on YouTube right now without getting a strike against you, and three strikes you're dead on your and getting your video taken down. So that's a fact. That's a fact that we do not have free speech on YouTube. Okay. And we don't have freedom of the press on YouTube. And I've done several videos about that tragedy. So this is the state of affairs. We're in a very volatile, dangerous time. And I do think that we may be looking at a civil war in the United States eventually. And I do think that, there are probably some earth changes that could split the country in half physically as well, such as the New Madrid Fault going and various things of this nature, unless they can kind of keep it together. And I do think these things are going to be triggered by weapons, earthquake weapons. They mm-hmm. definitely have earthquake weapons. I think what's happening to the volcano in Hawaii has been triggered. We have evidence, and I have a very good researcher named Paul Collin, who has written articles and done some deep digging. He's a former CIA NSA NOC, you call him. Basically, he was given a burn notice. Worked for the intelligence agencies as a financial NOC, and he went overseas for them on a job. When he came back, they stripped him of his passport and his health benefits, etc. And he has been living on the street ever since.
My gosh.
But he kept hold of his BlackBerry and writes articles for me for free.
Wow.
And we basically asked for donations to keep him alive. you know, and his blog is available on my my website. If you just go across the top menu items and just look at for guest blogs, you'll find Unwanted Publicity Guy, and that's Paul Collin. And he did a lot of investigation about a company called Ormat that suspiciously builds a strange company headquarters right next to various dormant or semi-active volcanoes. And they seem to have this technology as well as fracking technology. So that seems to be disturbing the earth in these areas as well. So there's a deeper story going on with these so-called weather changes and so-called global warming, which isn't global warming at all.
Yeah, it sounds like you brought up a good point, and that's an adjustment in population, movement in population to bring on perhaps and possibly a more catastrophic level to some of these agendas.
Sure.
Carrie, thank you so much for joining Wynwood Radio and Discussions of Truth. We look forward. I feel like we were just starting to go. So in the future, I will shoot you some talking points, and we can dive a little bit deeper into some of these other issues.
All right. Thank you so much, Ian, for having me on your show.
Okay. Bye.
All right. Bye-bye.
Ladies and gentlemen, Carrie Cassidy, very well researched. A la last Wednesday, Alana Freeland. And let's not forget, these are stalwart women that have dedicated their time and their life to try to create a better place for all of us to live. And at the end of the day, all of us individually can only play and do our best part. And that, in my opinion, is to be the absolute best we can be and treat people absolutely the best that we possibly can. As you visit my website and you look at some of the people, or all the people, that I have interviewed and brought onto this program, my mantra, my motto, and my slogan is be awesome. Simple as that. Miami-based weekly radio program. I am your host of Discussions of Truth, Ian Hamilton Trottier. We are independent, unfiltered, live, and unbiased. And until next week, please make your best effort to seek and destroy and simply be awesome.